Hi, everybody. Welcome to the session of five vital things to know before your first cloud project. My name is JR Redondo, and I'm here in product management at SolarWinds, and I'm today with Patrick Hubbard here.
Yeah, hey, everybody. I'm glad to see you. Thanks again for being a part of this session. You know, JR is actually the product line manager for our cloud properties, and certainly we've been talking about cloud and how to get started with cloud a little bit on SolarWinds Lab and some of our other videos, but it is great to have you on here and really focus on how to get started, and he's actually got screenshots and command line and a bunch of other really, really useful information about how to get started. So I think we're going to really get a lot out of this.
Excellent. Well, thank you for the invitation. By the way, what happened to your coat? I thought you guys always wear coats.
No. This is a presentation on cloud. This is my clean UX design.
All right. Excellent. Well, let's get started. I wanted to find something that would help me kind of give you an illustration of the cloud and the challenges in the cloud. And I thought, I'm going to use my favorite movie. My favorite movie is Mission Impossible, Ghost Protocol. This is a fantastic movie. I don't know, did you see it?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, 2011, the first movie ever in the series to be released in IMAX, and actually almost $700 million in worldwide gross revenue. So this is really the highest one in the whole franchise history.
Up and to the right, growth, it's good.
Yeah, exactly. In this movie, Agent Ethan Hunt lives in a world of unreasonable demands, right? He's a spy in the Impossible Missions Force, the IMF, which is a secret agency, and he has all of these challenges. Increasing national security demands, lack of funds, tight deadlines, small and secretive teams, clear and present dangers, and also a very rapidly changing world.
I don't know who that sounds like.
Well, interestingly, funny you mentioned that, this is really not unlike the challenges that you face as an IT professional. I don't know if this is you or not, but you know, some people only get to sleep while hidden in the server room, right, in some data center. So again, you have similar challenges to those of Ethan Hunt. Increasing customer demands, shrinking budgets, tight deadlines, reduced headcount, competitive pressures, and also, as Ethan Hunt's challenges, a rapidly changing world. So now, there is a very interesting scene in this movie, and this actually is set on Dubai's Burj Khalifa, which is the world's tallest building. It's about 2,700 feet tall, the way to the tip, about 163 floors, cost $1.5 billion to build. It's got 58 elevators, isn't that amazing? Anyway, Ethan's challenge is that he's on that floor and he really needs to get to a server room that is located on a different floor. And the bad guys are coming.
That's right. In IT, we don't do our own stunts either, so this is a real challenge.
Yeah, exactly. So there are 27 minutes until the bad guys show up. Now, here's what the scene looks like. I'm going to play it play by play and see if that works out for you. So first, there's somebody that says, well, we can get to it from the outside. And Ethan goes, we? Well, you know, somebody starts saying, well, I'm going to be on the computer. And somebody else says, well, I'm just a helper. Right, instead, finally, Ethan Hunt asks, what floor is it on? And it's 130th. 130th, right? There's got to be something else for us to do here. We can certainly use the vent ducts or the elevator shaft, right? But no, right? There are pressure sensors. There's infrared sensors. There's really no time. We got 27 minutes until the bad guys show up. So this is really a scene that, for me, in my experience, it really parallels very closely to the life of an IT professional. Somebody says, hey, we can do this with a month of all-nighters. You've heard of that, Patrick?
No, sure, especially when it's not any part of the implementation team.
Exactly. Well, somebody else is going to, well, somebody says, well, I'm just marketing. Somebody else says, well, I'm just procurement, right? Well, how much time do we really have? How much time and money? Well, 3 days and $130. $130, right? There's gotta be something else we can do. Maybe we can send somebody else to put some servers in the data center, or maybe we can tell customers to go away, right? But really, no, you can't, right? There is no more space, or we really need the revenue, and frankly, that is not enough time.
And nobody's gonna loosen up the budget.
Exactly. And so when the demands are unreasonable, just like with Ethan Hunt, in his case, he really needs this special kind of glove. This glove sticks the glass, right? And when he asks himself, how am I supposed to do this? Right? Somebody hands him this glove. This magical glove allows him to walk outside of the building and stick to glass. And now they ask, well, now remember, the blue color means glue. And when he's red?
No, he's dead.
It's dead, right? So think about this glove as your session. This session is going to help you think about the cloud challenges and your challenges today, and hopefully get you on your path to your first project.
And in IT, I think red is always the you're dead color.
Exactly. Well, exactly. So you will climb it, right? We're going to give you this blue glove, and you're going to be able to climb Burj Khalifa. So we're going to talk about five things. The first thing is going to be about how to get things done faster. Second thing, about how not to build or manage services that you can hire for. The third one is going to be about how not to operate, but also to automate. The fourth one, we're going to think about not just resources, also about the whole application and the whole service. And finally, how do we create a culture of transparency? So why don't we get started?
Absolutely.
So again, let's start first with the basics of the cloud. And there are a number of clouds already. While AWS was the leader in the market, they've certainly created the market and created the majority of the innovations that we see in all the clouds. Now there is a number of clouds already available. You can have AWS, you can consider Azure, Google Cloud, Heroku, Rackspace, SoftLayer, DigitalOcean, a number of clouds that are available for the particular needs and the requirements of your manageability and the requirements of your applications. One question that I always ask is, what are people doing on the cloud? And I tell them they're really doing largely the same things that everybody else is doing on-premise.
Only with a lot more DevOps.
A lot more DevOps, exactly. So they're developing, they're testing software, they're building web applications, building mobile applications, they're processing large amounts of data or deploying enterprise applications. Or, you know, in this case, I always think about them as building, expanding, and migrating applications, which probably doesn't sound too far-fetched or too far removed from what you already do in your on-premise application or your on-premise life.
Only you're doing it at a much, much higher rate.
Exactly. Now, what are the benefits that people see as they consider the cloud as an application deployment model for them? One of them is probably very important if you work in finance or you deal a lot with CFOs, right, in that the expenses now become variable expenses or operational. That means that, Patrick, like you, you probably charge to your own credit card and then use the expenses. Are you familiar with that in our infrastructure?
Not at all. And actually, as we talk about this, and I've talked to them about it before, I built our training infrastructure on AWS, and it was that first time that I ever had to go to corporate finance and say, hey, I need the big card number, and by the way, I'm not sure what the variable spend is going to be on that. So it required a little bit of education for that team on budget processes and POs. That was something that, you know, they're not used to with capital spend-based IT on-premise.
Exactly.
But we got past it.
Perfect.
They trusted me.
And then the difference is that you also pay as you go, right? So you, instead of having this huge expense, you actually paid on a monthly basis, or sometimes even more frequently than that. But I think the most interesting aspects of these is when you start thinking about how to see it affect or impact the technical problems here. In terms of fast provisioning, for example, or the ability to just have your capacity and shrink it or grow it elastically and programmatically. More importantly, I think what happens now in the cloud is that now you can think of your applications as something that can be deployed globally without the challenges that we traditionally have seen trying to do things globally with infrastructure that lives on-premise. But I really think that the most important reason why you should go to the cloud is because it allows you to do things faster. So it's this concept of agility that has to be probably also at a corporate level, but more importantly, at your level, the level of you as a worker, as an operations engineer, or as a systems administrator, and your teams in terms of getting things done a lot faster.
Well, there's a great opportunity for any IT admin there, because how often do we have to be the bearer of bad news, sort of the central apologist for people who are really trying to move the business forward? They're trying to be nimble, trying to react to new market opportunities.
Right.
And then you get into that infrastructure conversation where all they hear is, and IT always just says no.
Exactly.
So it's a great way to be able to jump past that and say, that's an excellent opportunity. Let's go capture that.
Exactly. And so Again, in this session, we're going to focus on AWS because it has sort of the largest breadth of services.
It's a grand old man of cloud.
It is. So for example, if you're come from the networking background, right, you go to AWS, you create your account, you already have a virtual private cloud, which is your private isolated network that you can use to attach resources to. These resources can be deployed on different regions, on different availability zones, right? And you can partition the network through subnets and routing tables, the things that you're traditionally used to. We're not going to go in detail across all these services. The list of services is actually pretty extensive now.
It's really frightening. You remember, frightening is maybe not the right word. Well, maybe it is the right word. Remember a few years ago, you'd go to the AWS console and you'd log in and there'd be five or six things on there.
Yeah, I remember 7 years ago when it was only one.
That's true. And at the time, you looked at their naming convention, you're like, I don't understand this. Why don't they just describe what they are? And now it all makes sense that they've gone with acronyms, because otherwise it wouldn't possibly fit in five tables on the front page. So there's just so many services that are available. Yeah,
they really need to have a search box in that page. They really should do that.
Yeah. Machine learning on demand, that's the
perfect. Let's talk now about compute. You can provision EC2 instances, you can provision your compute, your code on container services, on the new Lambda service that was recently announced. You can also provision storage services, right? You can have Elastic Block Storage Volumes or S3, which is HTTP accessible storage, or Glacier 4, sort of low cost storage. Databases, of course, they started with RDS, the relational database service for MySQL, and now they've expanded into a number of other databases, including a NoSQL store for sort of key value and maybe document-based data called DynamoDB, ElasticCache as well, and a number of other analytics services on top of them. AWS also has deployment and management services, right? Some of these services include Elastic Beanstalk, which is for deployment and management of web applications, CloudFormation, which is sort of these template-based provisioning services for AWS resources, and others sort of more of relevant for the DevOps processes of OpsWorks and code deployment, right? Including also identity and access management services and other important security services such as key management service, for example. Finally, there is also a number of application services that you can use in your applications. These include queuing, the ability to send emails programmatically, workflow, the ability to send notifications in terms of push messaging, and also some other services that are more applicable for mobile applications like Cognito and mobile analytics. All right, so why don't we start with the first one of these things that you really should know as you go into your first cloud project. And the first thing I want to call out is this idea that we talked about earlier, which is about getting things done faster. And this is something that we also saw as we were considering what do we do with some of our products that are more, that you've actually used in on-premise, right? And now customers like yourselves are asking us, what should we do with them on the cloud?
Well, but they drive us to everything, right? I mean, that's sort of the story of SolarWinds.
It's the story of SolarWinds.
Once upon a time, we did not want to do NetFlow. And then we didn't want to do applications. And then we didn't want to get into port management. And we continually respond to requests. And so the whole reason for now branching out into true cloud applications instead of just extended hybrid cloud is that that's what you guys were asking us to do.
Exactly. So something that you probably are familiar with is database performance analyzer. And the reason why we chose this example is because it is not unlike many of the applications that you already manage. It's a three-tier application. It has a web tier, it's application services, and also a database that we use for the collection of metrics as a repository. So we wanted to give you that ability to deploy it in a different way, right? With more flexibility and faster. So now you can have two choices. You can get a server and use it on-premise, or you can also go to AWS Marketplace and provision DPA through an AMI or an Amazon machine image. So let's take a look at how that will be done.
Three columns.
Of course. Mm-hmm. Search box. So let's click on AWS Marketplace. Then the first thing we do is search for SolarWinds.
And that's not, have to install that. That's already there. Just search for SolarWinds. It'll be the first one that comes up.
Exactly. So we click on it. Then we can see the product being described so you can read about it, learn more about it. Notice how you also can see the pricing information. In this case, this is bring your own license. That means that we really use the license that you already have. So you're not paying for the software, you're paying for EC2 resources. So let's click on that. By the way, you also have to select your region. It's important to decide where you want this asset to be created. So let's continue. So we click on that. And finally, we select what is the instance type that we want to deploy. In my case, I'm going to select M3 medium, which is a medium size. It's a good fit for what I need to do in this demo.
And there's a sizing guide online.
There is one online, one, yeah. By the way. Yes, you can go all the way out to large. We select a security group, select our VPC settings. Here's the pricing. Let's click launch with one click. Clicking launch gives us this screen. The instance is now being deployed. It takes a few moments for the instance to be created. You wait for that. Eventually, you see your instance in a running state. At that point, you can access the software. So you click on that, and now you're actually using the EC2 instance that you provisioned. You're actually using Database Performance Analyzer off of the AWS cloud.
Yeah, and the point is, if it could be running a server right next to your desk or in your data center in the cloud, it works exactly the same.
Exactly. Won't they say that? The cloud is just a server somewhere else, right? So let's accept the agreement. We accept the agreement, select our time zone. Wait a few moments. There is some configuration that DPA does as the instance wakes up. So let's do that. Then we log in.
Regular DPA login.
By the way, for the password, you just use your instance ID that you got from Amazon. That is really the one value that we can give you that is only known by you. So this is a very, very safe way. You can always obviously change the password. And then you click login. And voila, right? Now you have DPA running. This is a few days probably after I installed that. And now you can see the one database I had in my account already being monitored. So again, number one of the vital few things that you need to know on your first project, just remember that it is about getting things on faster. And the most important thing is going to be, how do you make your project a little more agile? While there can be other reasons, they can be financial reasons, they can be compliance reasons why you're going to the cloud, the one constant or the one common denominator in all these projects is because it allows your organization to be faster.
You think that's the reason why we're seeing traditional enterprise budget managers now a little bit more open to trading, a little bit higher initial expense to more flexibility to map to the business?
I think so. I think that is important, right? It's an important consideration in that now, whereas in the past, people were a little bit more reluctant to move to the cloud. Now that level of executive approvals and people that are in decision-making layers or levels within your company are already more open because they can see the benefit of kind of providing this agility to the rest of the organization. So the second vital thing to know as you're going into your next or your first cloud project is that you do not have to build or manage services that you can hire. Like for most of you, if your requirements allow for it, I mean, you're not probably Airbnb or Uber or a large company that needs to scale to tremendous amounts of what I call Google scale, then you can hire some of these services, just databases, load balancers, instead of having to build them and manage them from scratch.
Well, and I think this is actually the thing that's moved a lot of budget managers, because option B is you can articulate what it's going to mean in terms of staff cost to be able to add additional capability to your existing infrastructure. And for some reason these days, they will always go to a service-based, consultant-based, anything that is not CapEx whenever possible.
Exactly. It's just a no-brainer. So let's take a look at it. And the example that we're going to use in this case, we want to deploy a database, but instead of kind of installing it by ourselves, we're going to hire RDS. RDS is the relational database service from AWS. And again, you could have picked another example, but let's use RDS. Everybody's familiar with databases. So we click on RDS. We can get started now. We can launch our DB instance. In this case, I know many of you are familiar with SQL Server. So let's select SQL Server, and we select our kind of server web edition here. So we select that. In this particular demo, we didn't select the multi-availability zone deployment. It's a little more comprehensive, but it's really important for your failures to cover for that.
And I did that for the training environment. I actually used, and it took a little bit more thinking, and it also meant that I had to make sure that I had my VPCs configured in multiple availability zones.
It is really not that complicated.
But it added an extra maybe 20 minutes.
Yeah,
exactly. And then I essentially had an uninterruptible cluster.
Yeah.
For SQL, it was great.
Exactly. So we'll select no, and we'll just click on the next step. And now what we have is the ability to provide the details for this database. So in this case, we have the license, the engine version, the SQL Server, the instance class that we're going to be provisioning. Again, no multi-AZ deployment. How much storage do we want to assign to this database? And obviously, the settings for the database itself. the identifier, the username, and the password.
And if Tom were here, he would remind us that one of the nice things that it's doing here is it's also taking care of things that you normally might have misconfigured by an app owner in a virtual machine, like maybe thin provision a SQL Server instance, or even SQL Server specific, like don't allow auto grow, auto shrink. The things that can really hammer SQL Server performance are taken care of here by the template in the launch.
Right. Yeah, so let's click next. And some of those examples, some of those items that you mentioned are actually here as well. You can already provision for backup, right? Mm-hmm. So in this case, I'm going to set my retention period to 7 days. And no preference for my backup window, and also say yes to the minor version upgrades that might be needed.
And you can also specify your maintenance window, which is really nice. Exactly. Sometimes people think I lose application control. Almost any app that you are running on enterprise that are moved to the cloud and optimized will usually give you really critical things like, hey, by the way, this runs my finance department, and I really need to have control over when upgrades happen and maintenance windows.
Exactly. So let's launch this database. And then again, the instance is being created. Wait a few moments, you can view it, and here we have it. The most important thing to notice here is you get all the details here in terms of whether we provision with IOPS or we have different subnets. And the most important point here is that you have a database that looks, feels, it is exactly like the database you expected.
1433.
And we got our endpoint right here. We can just copy that. Let's say we copy that and then we connect to that server like the way you're used to connecting already. Using the login and the password that you specified, you connect to it, and now I'm doing SQL. So I basically just hired a database service, this database as a service, and I'm able to now use that database without having to be involved in the provisioning, the backup, and the maintenance of the service.
And all of my tools are the same. So if I'm used to Postgres or Oracle or whatever I'm using, I use the same tool set. I can't tell any difference about where it is.
Exactly. So for those of you that are maybe used to MySQL, right, you can use MySQL, the Workbench, right, or any other tools that you today use. So again, the whole point of this number two item is that you do not have to build manage the service that you can hire, right? Some services will come with certain restrictions. You're probably familiar with some of the restrictions on RDS. For example, you cannot be an administrator. Well, that's a trade-off you have, right? You get something and you have to kind of trade off something in return. All right, let's talk about number three. This item, I really like this item, which is the idea that your job now is morphing. You're no longer asked to operate only, but you're also asked to automate things. And you've probably been living in a world where maybe you have done manual operation, or maybe you do what I just call personal automation. You sort of write your own scripts and you manage things for your own job. But now you must move to a world where you become the developer of this infrastructure, because now the infrastructure is programmable. You can think about it as code. And the way I think about it is, always stop thinking about tickets, right? People still think about, hey, you need to create a ticket to do that. You need to create a ticket to do this other thing. Think about presenting an API to your developers.
And we actually have an entire session, which is a DevOps panel, talking about cloud and automation and using a program-driven infrastructure. And it was a really interesting chat. And one of the questions that came out of that was, how at risk are you in your career if you don't really start thinking this way about infrastructure? I definitely recommend that you all go check that out.
But that's a good one.
This is not optional anymore. These are skills that you're going to have to learn.
So let's take a look at how we can create a server via code. In this case, I'm using the AWS utilities, right? So I can say AWS, EC2, run instance for my Linux machine. I specify the image ID, which effectively identifies the instance type that I want to deploy. In this case, this is going to be an AMI that is loaded with AWS Linux, already pre-provisioned. And I'm going to ask for one of these instances to be created as T2 micro, which is really the smallest instances that I had available. I also identify the security group that I'm going to attach to this. Security group is basically rules for firewall traffic in and out. And also a subnet where this EC2 instance is going to be hanging off of.
Where to put it, who has access to it, and how big should it be?
And how many, right? As soon as I do that, you get this JSON back. And the one item that I want to call out is this called instance ID, which starts with an I, 9C993A75. That's really your ID. And as you can tell right here in the console, it's already spinning. You have already a server that is being born. So now, why get only one server when you can get five, right, Patrick?
Well, and by the way, huge props to you for having the bash up here. This is really, really great. Now, of course, in my example, and you're exactly right, when you can have five, I'm not doing this through the command line. In the training environment, I've actually used their SDK.
Oh, we're going to talk about that in a minute.
And it's entirely automated.
Exactly. So I just changed my script. I changed one to five in the count. And as you can tell, I'm already seeing the five servers being born. So this is really about, again, when we're talking about automating, this is really the most fundamental action, which is the action of doing something against a service such as AWS EC2 that allows us to do something with what in the past used to be hardware. In the past, we used to actually build things to do this. Now, something interesting, again, somebody's got to get paid, and that's going to be AWS. So now, your charges are going to start occurring, right? So now your charges are going to be based on usage. You pay based on the cost of the EC2 instance, size that you selected, the bandwidth that you consume, the storage, the IOPS if you use those. But again, the important thing is because you're using automation, you can always track this provisioning based on your needs, right? So there is no need to have idle resources sitting around. This is the case. In this case, this is just what I've been, for this demo, I have this account, and I've already incurred $156 of cost.
And believe it or not, this was actually the scariest thing for me in terms of the implementation, because we're really good about making sure that we have all of our accounting closed at the end of the month. They bill on the first or second of the month. And so as long as I can be close on what my spend is and give them an estimate, then I've got a couple extra days. And so I just keep an eye on it and actually just have them generate the auto report a week before the end. Then I can send the estimate over to accounting, and then they know within 5% how I'm going to come in. And that's helped move them past the fear that all of a sudden they're going to get some enormous out-of-band bill.
And AWS is great in case you do, right? You can give them a call.
The first time I was testing something, I asked it to spin up 100 instances of M3 large, and it refused and said, you don't have you're limited. So I had to call and open a ticket, and they actually asked a few questions, like, well, you know how much it's going to cost. And it was great, because then I didn't
dummy. I want to make sure that you know what you're doing.
Yeah, I'm going to dummy my way into a $10,000 charge.
Exactly. So again, just like I can create a server or five, I can also terminate them, right? So this is the way in the utilities that you can do that, right? So you just terminate instances, you pass the instance ID, and that's it. That instance, that server is actually terminated. It's done.
And it also sticks around in the log a little while. So the API will also tell you, and it's also in the UI, once it's been terminated, it kind of sticks around for a little while.
Sticks around for a few. Sometimes it's annoying. I don't like that.
Yeah, but how many times? Okay, if you're launching hundreds or, in our case, thousands of potential machines, every now and then you're trying to debug something. And you're like, did I terminate that box? All the logging gets terminated at the same time, that's a problem. So then it at least lets you know, yep, you terminated it, and it's now gone.
Yeah, so I guess here's where we can talk about pets versus cattle, right? Again, you're used to managing your systems as if they were pets, but now they're really cattle. You can just kill them, right? So on the left side, I have a pet. His name is Gunner. It's actually my family's pet. It's really like a family member, right? When he gets sick, we actually take him to the vet, right? Take him to the vet, rescue him. Whereas on the right side, you have cattle. They really have no name. They carry an ID. It's almost like their inventory, unless they are, of course, pets.
Yeah, they have an ear tag.
But then we don't use them as pets, right? We use them for?
Yeah, we eat them.
We eat them, right? Exactly. Cheeseburgers.
So in this example, like for us, we've got a whole bunch of machines that are the carefully tended example source machines for data, and then the student machines that connect to them. After those student machines are quite frankly infected from a security standpoint because they've had admin access to them.
Right.
Those are cattle. We shoot those, but then the ones that we actually have sample data and the rest of it are actually back here in our infrastructure with a VPN connection.
Great. Again, we're barely scratching the surface here. There are many other ways that you can programmatically do this. There are a number of SDKs, as you were mentioning earlier. Here's an example using Java, and the actions that you can do, it's a very large API.
And really pretty stable now. For a while, it jumped around, but in the last couple of years, it's kind of calmed itself down.
So again, remember, your job is not to operate, but to automate. Just think about it. You're becoming the developer of this infrastructure.
And it's also fun. The first time you use code and spin up a server without walking out there and even, you know, bringing up vCenter and messing with it, it's very powerful. And especially when it's from the command line, it kind of goes back to our tendencies to, you know, make sure that we're doing things with our fingers that can break things with a single character.
So I love that. But let's take it to the next level, right? Instead of automating for one single resource, let's think about it as a service-wide operation, as an application-wide thing. So now, again, remember, you're still the developer of the infrastructure. You're still presenting an API to your developers. But you don't want to do it only as a resource level, because then you're only just perpetuating what you've already done, which is think about resources. Now let's think about it as the whole application. So let's take a look at an example. And for this one, I'm going to use CloudFormation. So let's click on CloudFormation, and I'm going to create a new stack. And this stack is going to be my first ever WordPress blog.
My first stack. Excellent. It's the hello world of stacks.
Exactly. So I select the template, which is already pre-built, right? WordPress. I click next. Again, WordPress is a relatively sophisticated application. It's got a database, it's got servers, it's got security, and you need to select the instance type. Again, it's not a trivial application. Let's click next. Let's give it a name. Click next. We review it. We create it. And then it takes a few moments to actually create the full stack. We can see here that the create operation is in progress. And we can start to see some of the resources that are being automatically created by CloudFormation. In this case, we can see a web server. We can see the security group. And after a few moments, we can see the outputs, right? So let's click on output. And we can see that the website URL is already available. So we click on that. And now we get our WordPress blog, right? We fill in that information, we click on it, and then we can log in, right? Here's my username, my password.
That's based on what you filled out of the template.
Exactly, and now I got myself a WordPress blog.
Well, no, you got something better than that. You got a WordPress blog that, first of all, you didn't have to hand assemble, and it's also, that template has a lot of people involved with it. It has a lot of best practice that goes into its configuration, and it is more likely to be optimized for reliable delivery than if you just got out a spellbook and tried it yourself.
Exactly. I think that is a very important point, in that when you look at it, what we are doing here is we're reusing best practices through this idea of CloudFormation templates. As you can tell here, this is the section of parameters, the things that the UI asked us to fill in. Database name, database user, database password, the number of resources that we're going to use, in this case a web server, maybe some scripts or files that they need to be downloaded. Also, other scripts for the creation of the database itself. This runs on MySQL.
Custom post actions.
Exactly, some commands. And then eventually you get an output. And in this case, the single output is really the URL of that website. So again, now we've done number four. The item number four is really important, which is don't think only about resources, but think about the whole service. Think about the whole application. So now we're going on the fifth one. I really like the fifth
one. That's the last one.
The last one. The last one is really something that you're probably already familiar with, which is really how to create a culture of visibility. Because there are still going to be problems in the cloud. Again, your job is to restore the service as soon as possible. Applications are actually more complex, so you want to make everybody a participant in these outcomes. Just in this session, we've already created a number of things, right? We have a database, we have a server that I was using for my command line. Example, I had a WordPress blog, I got a database, I got a network, I got storage in those servers that I need to manage, make sure that they are actually operating as well. But you already know this, so there are two very important things to focus on. The first thing is, how are your users experiencing this application? And the second one is, what are your systems telling you, right, in terms of problems? So for this, I love to use some of our newest acquisitions, right? So Pingdom, Papertrail, and Librato. So let's go one by one. I really love Pingdom. It's really super simple to use, right, in our case. So let's just sign into this. Let's add a new check. Let's scribe. In this particular case, I'm going to use a transaction to check the logging operation so I can edit it. You know, it tells me if I messed up and I did something wrong here. Once I have it complete, then I can create the check, starts checking, and I can see my execution times and possible some failures. I can look at it over time and see the execution time in this case a little bit high, right? Maybe it's because I selected that small, tiny instance, right? More than a second.
Yeah, because you're, again, using a DevOps approach, you are constantly tuning and managing the resources that you've deployed and actually having the metrics to back it up are the
exactly.
only way.
Exactly. And I see you got your iPhone
Of course. Oh, the Pingdom mobile app.
The mobile app is fantastic.
Thing of beauty, yes.
So let's go to the next one. The next one is I really love Papertrail because it allows me to just solve problems super simply. Mm-hmm. And some of the problems are more complicated, and those are the ones that I really, really rely on Papertrail for. So let's sign in. This is the dashboard, Papertrail dashboard. Here are my servers that I've been managing. One of the things that I remember, like the first time I used Papertrail that I was struggling with, it was really late at night, and I was dealing with this Redis cluster. And unfortunately, late at night, port numbers really look identical when they're different. So I had 6739 or 6379. Hey, 3 in the morning.
Are you saying we can fat finger stuff even in the cloud?
I can't. Yeah, exactly.
Oh,
yeah.
Across hundreds of machines now, not just my own.
Exactly. So I was struggling with this problem, and I said, well, you know, okay, so I just went to my Linux box, right, added a line to my RSS log configuration file, as you can see here, then just simply restarted this, the logger, and there you go. Now, within a few seconds, right, Papertrail is already seeing the logs coming in from that instance, and sure enough, there was an error by Redis connecting to the port 6739 instead of 6379, right?
That never happens to anyone.
Never.
But it's actually a great point, because especially when you can geo-distribute applications, you might actually have some in AWS or Azure in another platform. You have a lot of variability in where those systems are operating, and having one place where you can consolidate all of that log information is really, really critical.
Particularly logs. They're really difficult to manage, but they're really useful. So you want to have them in a single place. So again, let's do the same thing, but let's connect it to our WordPress EC2 instance that we just provisioned. Again, went into the box. Let's find out what logger is being used, right? So just ls, right? Try to screen for syslog. And sure. Then right there, I can tell is our syslog. Again, like in the previous example, edit one line, restart, and within a few moments, I am already starting to see the logs automatically from that box. Again, you can disable that if you don't like to have your port open, which is something that I recommend. This is good for testing. It allows you to see your logs really, really fast. I want to talk a little bit about Librato. Librato is also one of my favorite tools at the company here. But one of the things that it allows us to do, again, it's really this beautiful tool to create dashboards that allow you to monitor your systems in the cloud, right? And from a variety of different sources and integrations that we support from databases, and it works through CollectD, so I really like that as well. So the first thing that you want to do, right, is to make sure that you have your security credentials. Mm-hmm. So you go into AWS, create an access key and a secret, or you copy that.
I like the way you just put it right there on the screen.
Exactly. I don't know how you protect your resources. All right, so we copy that, then we go into Librato, right, and we're going to add a new AWS CloudWatch integration. So we click on that, copy those two values, key ID and the secret access key, select the region that we were operating on, and then also select the services that are of interest to us, including EBS, I added ELB, billing, of course, never forget that, EC2, and then RDS.
Now, you could certainly go ahead and create a read-only security role and tell it exactly which one of those services it was allowed to access, and that's how I would secure my environment.
Wow, that's pretty good, actually. Yeah, exactly. IAM, right, very, very granular level of control that allows you to decide what access rights you're going to give to who. So it's really, really good for, particularly for those that have strict compliance requirements. Mm-hmm. So we save that. I can see that it already shows up in my Librato account. I click on it, and I have my dashboard, right? In this case, I'm showing the metrics from EBS, the Elastic Block Storage. But I think I also have EC2. Let's click Next. And yeah, I have some of the EC2 metrics already pre-configured. And interestingly, I was noticing these kind of little decline here. And one of the benefits of using Librato is that we allow you to integrate with the tools that are already part of the fabric of the way your team works. So I can have a snapshot off of this and then send it as part of a message into Slack. We use Slack internally, right? So maybe I just kind of say, hey, should I be worried about this decline, right? Is this something that I should be worried about using the Slack integration? I send that, and then when we go into our Slack channel, right? This is a channel that I created just for this demo, right? I can already see the chart already embedded there, right, from Liberato itself.
And it's great because it's there in the channel and people can either opt in or opt out of that Slack channel as need be. If you're an application owner and you have some interest, great, I want to actually see that. It's coming out of Liberato. You don't think twice about it. Now I don't need it. I don't care about it.
Exactly.
I'll just back out of that channel.
Exactly. Like in this case, right, just for the purposes of this demo, I have Jason, right, he joins in. He's like, hey, no worries. I'm just testing something. Okay, back to the demo, right? But then, again, the whole point of this is that we are able to do this right from within the way the team already works, right? We have a culture of, it's got very high transparency levels in terms of what's going on in the service, in the operation of the service, the problems that we're surfacing to everybody, right? And everybody can just come in and see what everybody else is working on.
And those three products together have hundreds of integrations for
exactly.
applications and frameworks.
Right. So again, remember, number five, right, is you want to create this culture of visibility. The applications are just becoming way too complex. There are way too many frameworks, way too many languages, way too many runtimes for everybody to know about everything that is going on in all those applications. So again, make sure that you want to make sure that all of your team members are participant in this outcome. Again, I want to leave you with a little bit of homework because then I feel that this becomes really, really theoretical. Create your AWS account or create your Azure account or your Rackspace account, whatever it is the cloud that you work on, and just in this case, I have an example for AWS. Right, just go. Your account is going to have a VPC. Create a subnet. Actually, create a route table first, then create a subnet.
You'll need that.
Add your security group. Create an EC2 instance. Start playing with this, right, to get a feel of how easy it is to manage applications with the cloud. And again, if you want to use, you know, Liberato or PaperTrail or Pingdom, then we're definitely ready for you to help. Ready to help you. Again, what have we covered today? Hopefully, these five things are something that we have armed you with to help you in your first project. Remember, the reason why you're doing this is to help your team get things done faster, right? Number two, remember, you don't want to build or manage services that you can hire. We provision that RDS database without ever having to install SQL Server. Your job is not to operate, right? To automate. Remember, we created one. With one line of code, we're able to create a server or five and actually delete it. Remember pets versus cattle, right?
Less fat fingering.
Exactly. Finally, don't think just resource level, right? Think about the whole application, right? Try to present a broad API to your developers that allows them to kind of be more productive. And finally, try to create a culture of transparency. Try to make sure everybody is a participant in the outcome of your application and your first project.
How great is that as an IT professional not to be an apologist? You're talking about services. You're not talking about servers. That's something that everyone else in your business can understand. And then you're not that guy who just constantly complains about numbers that they don't
always
understand.
Always just know. Yeah. Right? Exactly. And so again, our vision is to help you manage with all of the things that are in IT, whether they are on-premise, whether they are in your hosted or SaaS world, or whether they are on the cloud. You know, as always, we like to say that we're not just moving to the cloud, right? We're really adding the cloud to the number of services and products that we make available to you as customers, but we want to give you the tools and the products that allow you to manage these breadth of problems and systems and applications and networks that you have to manage, whether they are on either one of these deployment models. Because at the end of the day, we're not an expert in how to deploy these applications. You are the expert, right? You are the expert in your own business, in your own applications, but we want to give you the best tools available, whether, again, in either one of these deployment models, whether they're on-premise, SaaS, or the cloud. And again, remember, at the end of the day, hopefully with these little five things to know before your first cloud project. Now you have, like Ethan Hunt had, that glove, right, that allows you to stick the glass and climb that big building in Dubai. Hopefully this has been useful. So thank you, Patrick, for inviting me. It's been great.
JR, thank you so much. It was great having you. And it really is all about keeping that glove blue, not red.
Exactly. Well, thank you very much. If there's a question or you guys want to reach out to me, you can hit me in Twitter at JR Arredondo.
And Twitter, that's so cloud. Not email, that's awesome.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much, and we'll see you next time.